Okay, I want to start off by saying I am encouraged by people asking questions. I think one thing I have to do is get better at teaching this so that somebody might understand. I'm getting the impression that somebody might be starting to understand that what the Bible says is actually true. All right. And so I want to encourage people to continue to ask questions, okay? Because I want somebody to get this, to understand it, and to teach it. Because it's overwhelming how many false teachers there are teaching this idea of a millennial reign, and it's not in the Bible anywhere. And the reason why it's so evil is because you're telling people that they can wait until after Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven. They can wait until after the end of the world. And I'm here to tell you, that's as evil and wicked a doctrine as you could ever teach. We're Christians. We are the people of God. We ought to be teaching people that right now is your chance to be saved. Because when Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven, it's too late. Right? It's too late. There's a song that I kind of like, huh? Too, no, wait, never mind. I was gonna play it because I like that song, right? You've heard that song before, no? Let's see if I can just play 2 seconds, 10 seconds of it. This one, you remember this song? It was popular when I was a teenager. Of course. Too late when Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven. So let's go over this again. Now, I also want to share these the reign of Christ. It's just nonstop. People are just nonstop teaching this idea of a 1,000-year reign of Christ. And of course, I'm going to tell you, Jesus Christ does not reign 1,000 years. The Bible's very clear about that. He reigns forever. So you have to get over that fact that he does not reign 1,000 years, he reigns forever. And then you have to get over the fact that Revelation 20 does not make any mention at all about this idea of Jesus Christ reigning 1,000 years. It's not there. It's right in front of your face, and it's not saying anything at all about him reigning 1,000 years. It would contradict the whole entire Bible, but I want to go over Revelation 19. All right, Revelation 19, just to continue to hammer this point home that there is no 1,000-year reign of Christ. It's not there. All right, no matter how often or how many times they say 1,000-year reign of Christ, 1,000-year reign of Christ, millennial reign of Christ, millennium reign of Christ, it's just not there at all. Okay. Now, let's examine Revelation 19. I want to encourage you all to read Revelation 19, read the entire Bible. But I want to focus on this marriage of the Lamb. All right? And just think about it from a logical, common sense point of view. There's only one marriage. What kind of pervert are you to believe that Jesus Christ is going to have several marriages, or two marriages even. There's something wrong with the world today. To imagine that our Lord Jesus Christ is going to have multiple marriages. It's insanity. That's exactly what these people are teaching. Multiple marriages of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know what the marriage of the Lamb is? I mean, just from a logical, common sense point of view, you ought to know. I mean, it's not rocket science. You ought to know the marriage of the Lamb is when Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven and we are resurrected from the dead. We are lifted up. We are changed in the twinkling of an eye. We are lifted up to meet the Lord in the air. That's the marriage. When we ourselves are resurrected. Jesus Christ resurrected from the dead and ascended to heaven. He has promised to come back for us. When he comes back for us, that is the marriage of the Lamb. And there's only one marriage. I mean, that's it. If you're not part of this marriage, it's too late. Too late for love, right? It's too late. And, of course, here in Revelation 19, it talks about this marriage of the Lamb. And his wife, the wife is the people of God. The saints, the elect of God. Those of us that are born of the Spirit of God today are the people of God. And we are a part of this body of Christ. The body of Christ is the bride, is the wife. Okay, and there's only one marriage. I can't say that enough, really. All these people that are teaching a thousand-year reign of Christ, all these people that are teaching, okay, Jesus comes, we're resurrected, and then a thousand years, there's another resurrection. It's this perversion is what it is. It's disgusting, it's evil, and it's wicked. All right, so let's continue here. Let's see, let me read a little bit here. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. The righteousness of the saints is the righteousness of faith. Now, don't forget, this right here is talking about the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, the wife. All right, don't forget that. It's kind of important. And he says unto me, excuse me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. All right. Now, let's see. I saw heaven open. Behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called faithful and true, and in righteousness he does judge and make war. Okay, so obviously, the one that sits on the white horse is Jesus Christ. When he comes back, and that's the marriage between Christ and his body. All of us that are saved. First the dead in Christ, then those of us which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Now that on the other side of that is the unsaved. And the unsaved is going to be gathered together. Just like what we read in Matthew 13. The parable of the wheat and the tares. The wheat is gathered into the barn. The tares are gathered in bundles to be burned. Now this is when Jesus makes war, when he judges and makes war. The judgment is, are you saved or are you not saved? If you're saved, then you're of the body of Christ. If you're not saved, then you are destroyed. Okay, so this is what that means, and make war. And his eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself, and he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. Now, I want to share something with you to give you an idea. When this happens, when Jesus makes war, when he's on his white horse, and he's making war against the unsaved, this is when we are already up in the air. All right, think about Revelation 3, verse 9. I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. So here in Revelation 19, we read about, and the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen and white and clean. So the armies would be the angels of God, but we're up in the air with the Lord Jesus when this war takes place against the unsaved. We're not going to be down here on the earth dodging bullets. We're going to be up in the air with the Lord. And the whole world of unsaved people are going to know that God loves us. And there's not going to be any doubt about it at all. And this is all throughout the Bible. It really is. And the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. All right, this goes all the way back to Genesis 3. If anybody's been paying attention, you hear me repeat this over and over. But it's very simple. It's very simple, but it's very important. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Of course, this is God talking to the serpent. I will put enmity between thee and the woman. Okay, the woman came from man, right? Out of Adam came woman, and then out of the woman came Christ. So the seed of the woman is Christ, and if you be her seed, then you be Christ. Right, and heirs of the righteousness of God. Okay, just like what we read in Galatians. Is it Galatians 3? I forget already. I don't know nothing. Yeah, Galatians 3. And now to Abraham and a seed were the promises made. He saith not into seeds as many, but as a one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. And if you be Christ, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Now this is the same thing. The same thing. Because the seed of the woman is Christ. The seed of Abraham is Christ. It's the same thing. All right. And so the seed of Christ, or the seed of the woman, which is Christ, shall bruise the head of the serpent, and the head of the serpent will bruise the heel of Christ. That means we're up in the air. We're up in the air. I thought we were up in the air. What'd I do? Well, anyways, and like in what we read in Revelation 3. In Psalm 110, so on and so forth. And it's all there, all throughout the Bible. Many places, really. It's just saying the same thing over and over and over and over and over again. We are up in the air with the Lord. Fire comes down from God out of heaven and devours them all. Right there, it's the same thing. Same thing. Alright, so when this happens, when this happens, we're all up in the air, and our enemies gathered at our feet, and out of his mouth goes a sharp sword that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. He treads the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. All right, now, along with the marriage, there is the marriage supper. Now, what do you do in preparation of the supper? You slaughter the animal, right? So, and the animal, in this case, is going to be the unsaved people. All right, so the great supper is essentially going to be for the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven. And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God. Now, that's going to be quite a scene, really. You're going to have all these dead people on the ground that were destroyed by God, and all the fowls in the midst of heaven are going to get really fat. They're going to have all kinds of food to eat. It's going to be something else. The great supper, right? That ye may eat the flesh of kings. I mean, they're not just eating bums and drug addicts and murdered people or whatever, you know. They're eating the flesh of kings and the flesh of captains and the flesh of mighty men and the flesh of horses and them that sat on them. And the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. Right? I mean, this is going to be quite the supper for these little fat birds. And I saw the beasts and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat upon him. Sat on the horse and against his army. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped the beast and his image. These both were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth. And all the fowls were filled with their flesh. They had great, they're going to have great big bellies. And they're going to be so fat, I don't think they're going to be able to fly anymore. Nevertheless, that's important to understand what's going on here in Revelation 19. Okay, so this is the marriage. Now we go to Revelation 20. And I saw an angel come down from heaven. All right, we're essentially given another vision, a new version, if you will, another angle, another picture to see and to understand what's going to happen at the end of the world. This cannot be, okay, and then after the end of the world, there's going to be another end of the world. You know, you can't say after judgment of God, after the marriage of the Lamb, then there's the judgment. That's not logical. It's not common sense. I don't even think it's honest. I really don't. I don't think people are being honest. Now, you have to be honest with yourself first. And once you're honest with yourself, then you can look at the scripture objectionably, you know. You can look at the scripture and see it for what it is. All right, because I'm telling you, people aren't looking at the scripture. They're listening to Reverend Schmitty, who Reverend Schmitty doesn't have any idea. And he's teaching you because you don't have any idea. And then you're going to pass that on to the next guy that hasn't any idea at all. The whole time, the Bible never changes. It stays the same. There's no mention at all of Jesus Christ reigning 1,000 years. Right? All this is saying is, hey, there's this 1,000-year period, and we are in this 1,000-year period. It's not hard to figure out. All right? Right now, there are people who are beheaded because they are a witness of Jesus and for the Word of God. All right? There are people that, I mean, we take part in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He is the first resurrection. Now, how can you rightly say that you're saved if Jesus Christ is not reigning in your life right now? All right? If the second death has no power over us that are saved. Right now, we are priests of God and of Christ right now. Right now, Jesus Christ reigns in our life. I know he reigns in my life. Are you saying that he doesn't reign in your life? If you're saying he doesn't reign in your life right now, aren't you really saying that you're not saved? Think about it. This is clearly happening right now. This is not after the end of the world. This is not after our enemy is destroyed. This is not after the marriage of the Lamb. Right? This time period right now, and then at the end of the world, I mean, this is consistent all throughout the Bible. At the end of the world, Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven. We are lifted up. Our enemy is gathered at our feet, and fire comes down from God out of heaven. It's a one-time deal. I think, what was that? Revelation 19. It might have been right there in 16. I'm just going to ignore that for right now. It is finished at this point. All right, the work is done. Everything is complete. And there's no more wickedness after this. All right? And so also, there we go. And so also after the marriage of the Lamb. It's essentially telling you the same thing in two different ways. And it's not just here. It's all throughout the Bible. And it's throughout Revelation as well. Okay. Now, in Revelation 20, this great white throne and him that sat on it. All right. It just use common sense here, really. And realize that, hey, this is talking about Jesus Christ. Right? I mean, it's the same thing. Behold, a white horse and him that sat upon it. This is all talking about the same thing. It's not. This is not talking about one person and this about another person. All right. So also, this is not talking about one event and then this another event. When you see that the end of the world is the marriage of the Lamb and the destruction of the wicked, you see clearly that this is the end of the world and the marriage of the Lamb. I mean, you put the pieces of the puzzle together, you connect the dots. It's really simple. But it requires faith. It requires faith in what you're reading. Okay? So when you read Revelation 20, verse 4, for example, it does not say Jesus Christ reigns 1,000 years. It's not there. So also in verse 6, it does not say Jesus Christ reigns 1,000 years. It's not there. I mean, look. I'm showing it to you. It's right there in front of your face. It does not say Jesus Christ reigns 1,000 years. It's not there. We live and reign with Christ right now during this 1,000 years. There's no mention at all of Jesus Christ reigning 1,000 years. There's no mention of him his reign ending. Quite the opposite, he reigns forever, right? And so also here we can parallel this, the judgment, with the end of the world, because this is prophesied all throughout the Bible, the great day of the Lord, judgment day. This is it right here. It's also the marriage of the Lamb. When Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven, we are changed in the twinkling of an eye. And the first, the dead in Christ shall rise, and then those of us which are alive and remain are caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. This is the end of the world. We are gathered up with him in the air, and our enemy is gathered at our feet. This is the judgment. The judgment of, do you have sin or do you not have sin? You have to have zero sin in order to be changed from mortal to immortal. You have to have zero sin. The only possible way to have zero sin is if Jesus covers your sin. You can't do it yourself. You can't do it yourself at all. You got no chance. You've got zero chance. You have zero chance to have zero sin. And with men, it is impossible. With man, it is impossible. You cannot do it. The only way you can have everlasting life is through him who has zero sin. All right. Now, again, I mean, this is the same thing. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. You know, this goes back to Daniel 12, right? And this is all throughout the Bible. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. This is not multiple resurrections. There's not multiple ends of the world. There's one end of the world, right? There can't be more than one end of the world. If there was more than one end of the world, then the end of the world would not be the end of the world. Come on. This is common sense stuff. The second death, of course, is this judgment. If you're not saved, you will die the second death. Right? That's pretty simple stuff, man. Pretty simple stuff. So just to reiterate here, just to keep trying. I want to keep trying. Because the deception is so out of control. It's incredible. It's absolutely incredible how many people are getting this wrong. There is no millennial reign of Christ. It's absolutely incredible. So let me just finish and reiterate here. For when the marriage of the Lamb comes, this is when he comes in the clouds of heaven. Alright, when he comes in the clouds of heaven, it is the end of the world. You think about Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21. Jesus is asked specifically about the end of the world. And what happens at the end of the world? The sun is dark and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then Jesus appears in the clouds of heaven, and he shall send his angels to gather together his elect. That's the end of the world, folks. There is not multiple ends of the world. If there's multiple ends of the world, then the end of the world is not the end of the world. Pretty simple stuff, man. This is not rocket science. The problem is people are not trusting the Bible that they read. They're trusting in false teachers who don't understand themselves. I mean, this is obvious right here. And I'm a victim of it. You're a victim of it. We're all victims of false teachers. So that's why I find it so imperative that I continue to teach this until somebody gets it, at least. Once somebody gets it and they start teaching it, they'll probably be popular. And nobody listens to me. I'm not a good teacher. All I can do is show you the truth. The truth that there is no thousand-year reign of Christ. Jesus reigns forever. And Revelation 20 is only speaking of this time period now, where we reign with Christ right now. We live and reign with Christ right now. We are priests of God and of Christ right now. We are called to preach the gospel to every creature. We're called to be priests. We are a royal priesthood, in fact. Right? And you go back to even Revelation 1. We are kings and priests of God right now. We are kings and priests of God right now. Right now we're kings and priests of God. Right now. And has made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Right now. We are kings and priests. We are a royal priesthood right now. So when we turn to Revelation 20, and then all of a sudden you say, oh, we're not priests of God right now. There's something wrong, man. There's something wrong. You spent too much time listening to... I'm not sure about that guy. But all these other guys, right? All these other guys that are preaching a thousand-year reign of Christ. Right? I mean, it's unbelievable. It's incredible. How this gets taught, and it's not found anywhere in the Bible. So, see, when Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven, it is the end of the world. It is now too late. It's too late for the unsaved. Right here, when this happens, it's too late. Think about this. I mean, not only are we going to know it, the whole world's going to know it's too late. It's too late. The tribes of the... all the tribes of the earth, everybody is going to know it's too late. Even, think about this, man, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. And they're going to know. They're going to know it's too late. They're going to know. And they said unto the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. They're going to know. At that point, it's too late. You cannot be saved after it's the end of the world. Your only opportunity is right now. Because when Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven, it's too late.